We pray, we're ready to study, the anointing should still be on us. Somewhere, faith worketh by love. I know it could be Philippians. Well, we'll go ahead and teach, and then someone will run by it in a little bit. Our lesson today is Jesus teaching us, and we're coming from Matthew, the 5th chapter, verse 43. Matthew, the 5th chapter, verse 43 through 48. Our lesson on it divides of just 6 scriptures, just a few scriptures, but we're going to reference a lot. And I guess this is the acid test. It's not the acid test of how you get into heaven. Make sure we understand that. It's not the overall way that you get into heaven. It is to show that you have the life of God abiding in you if you can do what Jesus said regarding these scriptures. And that if I show, demonstrate charity, I'll gain access to heaven. Well, you can't get into heaven without it. But it is not, it does not qualify you as being redeemed. Redeemed is based on Romans 10, chapter, verse 9 and 10. You believe in your heart and confess with your mouth. That's where salvation comes in. But our lesson is showing that if you have the nature of God and can absorb anything in life and demonstrate the love of God deliberately and on purpose, then you have proven that you are definitely a child of God. So let's check this out. Because that's why I wanted to find that scripture. I just didn't find it this morning, but faith worketh by love. But love is how we got out of the Old Testament, the law, and to the grace that we're in today. God was so mad at the world, he caused a flood. So fed up with sin, so fed up with humanity, whom he had made, loved, and created, his masterpiece, so fed up with it, he caused a flood to destroy those, except for Noah's family. But God also realized that destroying mankind for his sinful nature and punishing mankind for his sinful nature would not bring mankind into the state of being that God wanted mankind to be. For example, you can't beat your kid to make him love you. Go punish you until you love him. A husband, you can't beat your spouse. A wife, you can't beat your husband up until he starts loving you. Just won't work. So there's got to be another way to achieve and bring that love out. And here it is, the best way to do it is through demonstration, deliberate demonstration. That's why we come up with St. John 3:16. One of the most powerful scriptures ever said, ever in the whole world. Who can say it? St. John 3:16. Even people that don't go to church, not been in church, can walk by a church and see that, remember it, look it up. Everybody know that. What does it say? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. But whosoever believeth in him should not perish. God so loved. So how do we know he loved us? He demonstrated it by Jesus dying on the cross.
Galatians 5:6.
How's that, Candy?
Galatians 5:6.
Galatians 5:6. If you want your faith to work, here it is. Galatians 5:6. Bible thumbers, those who have thumbed through the New Testament before, find that. Galatians 5:6. Yeah. Okay, so here he says here, "For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which work by love." If you want to get there, get it accomplished, you want your faith to work, it has to be motivated by love. Parallel. You got all the faith, no love. Won't get it. Got all the love, no faith. It won't work. So that takes us to 1 Corinthians 13 and 13. We ain't even got to our lesson yet. 1 Corinthians 13, 13. Where we are in this. 1 Corinthians 13, 13. When we get there, say, amen. She came back. She must have had a good time when she was here the last time. Okay. Amen. All right. Well, we're gonna have her read it then. Go right ahead.
13. Uh-huh. "Now I speak with the tongue of men, of angels, and have not charged. I am becoming as sounding brass."
Oh, okay, let's read just the 13th first.
Oh,
I'm just
sorry.
The 13th verse.
I'm sorry.
That was good with this one. Get too deep on me.
"And now abundant faith, hope, cherish thou free, mm-hmm. but the greatest of this is cherish."
Okay, now.
Cherish.
Now. And now about it, what?
Faith.
And what?
Hope.
Cherish. These three. What's the best?
Charity.
The greatest is charity. The greatest is love. So no matter how God could have spoke to them in the Old Testament and saved Israel and done all that good stuff for them, until they seen him demonstrate his love for them, it's the only way that they would cause, that's the only way he can get God cause mankind to respond to him, Gentile or Jew, is that he demonstrated his love. Same way for us today. If you want things to respond to you, a friend or a foe. Mm-hmm. Got that, Sister Sylvia? Friend or foe. Friend or foe. The only way you win, get them to come to your side of the fence, your side of the table, your side of the issue, your side of the whatever, the deal, whatever, is that you demonstrate love. You just burn them up if you just show love. Whew. You got, and that's a deliberate act.
Absolutely.
On purpose.
Yes, to be.
On purpose. The only way you're going to win it. Now, and they didn't teach it like that from Genesis to Malachi in your Bible. It's not taught like that from Genesis to Malachi. Mm-hmm. Only when you get from Romans to Jews did you see it taught like that. Taught like that. Now Jesus demonstrated it and talked it like that in his earth walk, but they couldn't catch on to that. How can we get there to what you're talking about, Jesus? Well, he says, first, you have to have my nature. You have to have my, you have to be like me on the inside of you for you to do it like that. Because another profound scripture, Luke 23:34. Let's look there real quick. Sometimes you can see love in action and you can just say, I don't know how they do it. I don't know how they do it. It's still, people are still puzzled and tripped up when they see deliberate love, a love in action. Mm-hmm. And 23:34, get there and say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Right. First hallelujah to read.
Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they did. And they parted his raiment and cast lots.
All right. Mm-hmm. And this is when they're killing him. Mm-hmm. He's on the cross, terrible, shameful death. Mm-hmm. Hanging up there naked, exposed to the whole world, beat up, so beat up he can't recognize who he is. And he says, right there, is what? Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. Killing them. Now, that takes, how many can do that when someone's beating you to death, stoning you, husband abusing a wife? And I saw a deal on the news the other day where the wife videotaped her husband beating her. And I saw when she get the police to respond. Must have been last night, night before. Yeah. So the only way they would have believed that he was doing that, that she secretly videotaped it. And he just sexually abused her right there in the marriage. And then to come out, they went to court, got the divorce, she has to pay spousal support.
That's a case where you would say, Father, forgive
me. Father, forgive me. What are you doing?
Yes, hey, but Brother Donnell, you know, that's different what type of job you hold. I mean, I got to use myself for prime example. I run across a lot of people, a lot of people. And I don't care how much time, how much you be kind to them, they still run over you. I don't care how much you give them to them, they still
perfect
run over
for,
you.
Perfect for today's lesson. We're going to show you why. How come they not love me? Why they treat me like that? I'm doing the best I can. I'm showing my love to them. Whatever. What's going on? I'm going to show you that. Jesus is going to point that out here in just a quick minute. So I'm just trying to show you that even in a deep, bad situation that you're in, you're taking it on the chin, life's upside down for you. If the only way that you prove that you are God's child, demonstrate, let it be known that you are God's child, is you do a deliberate act of love. And you keep doing it. And you always do it. Hanging on the cross, dying. Naked, exposed to the world, Father, forgive them. So his disciples down there looking up and say, you say what? All right. Let's see it in action again. Acts 7 chapter, verse 60. It's the New Testament in action. That's what Acts means. It's the activity of the believers. The activities, what they did. Those that believed in Jesus as risen Savior, what they did. We're going to get to how they did it here in a minute, but we're going to just talk about what they did once they took on his nature. That's a clue, brother. What did he do? This man, here's the story, this man has been beaten up. Stoned to death. I think that's going to be up there somewhere, verse 59. As soon as you get there, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right, who's going to read it? Start at verse 59, chapter 7.
I'll read it.
You got it? Who said it? Okay, go ahead, brother.
And they stoned Stephen upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And he knelt down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep.
Okay, that killed him. Stoning, very good. They were stoning him to death. Stoning him to death. Stoning him to death. And here he is, killing me. And he said, he did what? He prayed for them as they were killing him. And not only he didn't pray silently, but he said he prayed loudly. And in verse 60, he kneeled down, cried with a loud voice, Lord, don't charge this sin to me. And when he had said that, he died. How many can do that? Brother Curtis, they caught you in the parking lot over there by Walmart. Beat you up. Takes about 5 or 6 of them because you're a big guy.
I call you, brother. See, that's free, brother.
Big guy, it's going to take about 5 or 6 of them to take you down. They're taking you down. They got you. Boom, boom, boom. It's over with. What's Curtis going to do? Lord, the latest to their charge. I love them. Forgive
me. But you know something, human nature would just extinct and you would fight back. That's just your human nature.
Okay. You're going to fight back something, get mad at something? Human.
Yeah, human nature, ability. I mean, just death. That's instinct until you catch yourself. And, hey, yeah, but you still got to protect yourself.
Sure. That's the quality of a human life. First virtue. I'm number one. I'm going to make sure I get out of this fire. Let a fire come up in here and see this first one. I'll demonstrate how much I love you. Or who I love the most.
That's how I know.
You know, I'm going to protect myself. But if the Lord, but the Lord is, you know, he's, you know, when the rubber meets the road,
thank you.
I'm hanging y'all. Someone come in. I'm hanging every one of y'all in there. Who you going to vote for to be the first one to step up there? So, how do I get this God kind of love in me where I can forgive a person while they're killing me? I can pray for them. How can I do that? Because this is where you got to step up too. Christ is here. Here we are trying to get there. Right. And he says, until you get there, you have not shown or demonstrated that you are a child of God. That you have his very nature living in you. Tough. Who wrote this Bible anyway? God. So here we go. If he tells us something, then whatever God tells us to do, he also gives us a means, a provision. This is how you do it. When y'all ready to say how you do it, raise your hand. Everybody ain't ready. I still got somebody out there I got to get even with. Still got some scores to settle. Just before I get saved, brother Al. Hold up. Got to get this straight with this rascal over here. Okay. All right. So, let's get. Y'all ready for the how?
Yeah.
How do you do this? Okay. All right, here's the first thing I'm going to learn, that it sets you apart. Love, God's love in you, working in you, sets you apart. Okay, sets you apart. And maybe we'll dive into our lesson and we'll see how. I'm going to tell you right off the bat that you're just mediocre at best without God's love in your life. Without demonstrating God's love. You're just mediocre, just like everybody else. Mediocre. Average. And you have to be above average. To demonstrate to be a child of God. You have to be above average. Okay? All right. We're getting there? Okay. Let's go to our lesson today. Matthew 5:43. This is our lesson text. All right. And Jesus is giving them the things about the kingdom of God. He gets on down to where he says, verse 43, you have heard. Now he's talking to a crowd that's coming out of, that's an Old Testament crowd, and he says, you've heard this teaching. You've heard this teaching, the rabbis have taught it, and all of them have said this. What have they said?
Love thy neighbor. Hate thine enemy.
The preacher said that, Sister Hill. That's what the preachers were saying back in that day. And guess what? Everybody bought into it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate that. Who said that? The rabbis, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and all those guys. The Levites, all of them said that. Is it written like that anywhere? Are we ready to see? Is it written like that in the Bible? Yeah, it is. I was supposed to write down Leviticus something. Leviticus 19, chapter, verse 18. Yeah. Leviticus is the book of do's and don'ts.
You should say it again, brother Donnell.
Leviticus 19 and 18.
All right.
It's right after Exodus. Okay, what did he say there? Okay, what's the intention meet here? He says, thou shalt not avenge, don't avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of who?
Black people.
Who?
Black people.
All black people.
Black people.
Black people. People like you and your race. You're wrong with them. All black people, all Northsiders, get along. That's what they're saying. Anybody outside your circle, fair game, go get them. How many mama, I was raised with 8 brothers. Somebody got some brothers in your house, families raised with. Huh? Y'all got, did they have your back? Yeah. Your brother come home from school and say somebody jumped on him on the playground or somebody on the way home from school. Oh, war zone. Here we go. Somebody pulled your sister's hair. Oh, here we go.
Yes.
Here we go. War zone.
Sure.
And your mama and your daddy did what? Taught you that. So, cousin, whoever, we take care of one another. These are my people. They mess with you, mess with one, you got to mess with all of them. That's why I had no problems in nobody's life. Got 8 brothers? Shoot. Two. You mess with me, it's on. Everybody knew that. You fight him, you got 7 more than him. Plus 2 or 3 sisters. Don't tell anybody no cousins and all. So that's what they taught. Your mom and your daddy taught you that, and that's ingrained and it's deep in our brain that if they're not one of us, we're going to take them out. Yeah. And that's what it was taught. Children are not people. But your neighbor, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as who? As thyself. I am the Lord. And Jesus flipped back. So we're going to run back over to that Jesus teaching in Matthew. So we see that we got some contradictory stuff going on here to a degree. So here we go. Here we go. You have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. So what did Jesus say? Someone help me out there. Verse 44.
But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you.
I mean, they're doing some bad stuff to you. Jesus says the preachers have taught you to hate, who to hate, who to love. But he says, but I'm telling you, love your enemies. Mm-hmm. Wow. Do what to them that curse me out?
Bless them.
Mm-hmm. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them that treat you all bad. And deliberately trying to destroy you. Wow. Now listen, that's one thing for you to say and do. But how do you expect me to do that? That's just an average guy, average Joe Blow. Now, I don't know what Luke 10:29 is saying, but I'll flip there right quick. Just right before the book of John, if you got a Bible, Luke 10:29. Da-da-da-da-da. My Father which gave to me is greater than all, and only who plucked them out of my hand. So, we won't get tied up there. Let's let that go for a minute. So love is a deliberate act. We talked about that. They hate you. Pray for them. They treating you bad. Persecuting you. Do good to them. Now, if I don't do that to my business partners that is trying to jack me up all kind of ways, beat me out of money all kind of ways, got me watching like a hawk all the time. And he says, I love my Northside Christians in the church. But the Mormons and JWs and all them, oh, I just hate them. See them walking up and down the street. Let me put a nail out there so they can get a flat and can't go to nobody out of the neighborhood. That's what I should do, right, Sister Hill, for the sake of the gospel.
No.
Keep them from spreading those false rumors.
Absolutely not. Wouldn't that slow them down a little bit or something? It may slow them down.
It's
not the right thing to do.
Just can't do that. Pray for them. Do good. To them, neighbor, boss, whoever, co-worker, so whoever it is doing you wrong, you have to do a deliberate act of love toward them.
Absolutely.
Wow. Just to prove that you are a child of God. And you say, I can't do it, guess what you're not proving?
You're proving what you really are.
You're just mediocre. You're just average. Jesus don't point that out here. You're just average. And I don't want to call somebody to backslide. I'm just telling you the deal. If you can't demonstrate God's love and come on through with some deliberate act of love, you're just showing that you're just average. Oh, man. Okay, here we go. Verse 45 says why? That you may be the children of your Father, which is in heaven. What he's saying is that you can show that you got a heavenly Father. Mm-hmm. That you can show that you got a heavenly Father. For he maketh his Son to do what? Son, S-U-N, to do what? See, he was mad at everybody back in the day of that flood and killed everybody. Then he said, God says, you know what? This is not going to solve the problem. This is not going to make them love me. And so he says, I swear, I'll never, as mad as I ever get at mankind again, I'll never cause a flood again. I got the right to be mad. I am mad. And I did kill him. But then he said, that won't cause him to love me. So he says, I'll never do that again. And his proof of that is that what? He causes the rain and the sun to shine on who? Everybody. And everybody benefits. Everybody eat the crops that the rain and the sun produce. And all like that. He causes the... So he says, I'm showing my love to everybody. Everybody gets my goodness. Does everybody deserve his goodness? No. You know, that boss, that contrary boss, that contrary spouse, enemy, friend, do they deserve this love that I'm going to give to them? No. No. They don't deserve it. But guess what? I'm going to give it to them. Because God has given it to me and he gives it to everybody else. And for me to say that I'm God's child, I'm going to do what he does. And now, matter of fact, that's what he said for me to do. Do what he does. This is really a 3-week lesson because the things you can do, when you put love on your enemy, you just destroy him. He'll melt right in front of you. But we're not going to get into that. Sister Hill proves that one Sunday. Next time she's up.
Okay.
Yeah. Love will destroy your enemy. Boom. He can't take another step when you put real genuine love on him. He's over. It's over with for him. But we're getting.
I think it's important to know here that statement you made is very accurate.
Mm-hmm.
To kind of supplement that is, they can't, but it may not be immediate. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's a process, just like love is a process that we have to deliberately choose to love.
Mm-hmm.
That is a process of that unfolding in terms of the enemy succumbing to it. It's a process.
Yeah.
It may not be just
quick. It may not fall right.